Promises, and we discussed what promises actually are. Today's the first message as we look at a year of promise, and what better promise than to look at what Jesus promised us that we're going to be able to see him one day. We shall see Jesus. I have called your attention to Acts chapter 1. 40 days since Passover, 10 days prior to Pentecost, Jesus has done a lot of things since his resurrection. Now we find him on a hillside. The disciples are with him. And while they are talking to him and while they are conversing back and forth, the scripture says that he ascends up into heavens. Verse 10 says, and while they looked steadfastly toward heaven as he went up, behold, two men stood by them in white apparel, which also said, you men of Galilee, why stand you gazing up into heaven? This same Jesus, which is taken up from you into heaven, shall so come in like manner as you have seen him go up into heaven. Mixed emotions that day with the apostles. What a roller coaster it had been for nearly a month and a half. My, to see him come in to the city of Jerusalem, and it seemed like all of Jerusalem was behind him and praising him. And a few days later, that same group cried out, crucify him. As they hid in fear, then Jesus Christ appeared in the upper room and showed to them the power of God and the promise of God about being resurrected. And yet for the past some 40 days, he had been sharing some things that's very, very important. Oh, and the excitement was back again. Then suddenly he disappears right before them. And the emotion starts all over again. And yet those two angels appeared and said, fellas, listen, as you've seen him go, you're going to see him come. Now there's the promise right there. I like 1 John 3:2. Behold, now here's one of those guys that saw him. John the Apostle. Now he pens down another one of his letters, and notice what he says, behold, he said, beloved, now are we the children of God, and it does not yet appear what we shall be, but we know that when he shall appear, we shall see him, for we shall see him as he is. That apostle remembered that promise. But there are some things I want to call your attention to. You turn over to the book of Hebrews, if you will. Book of Hebrews, chapter number 9. In verses 24 through 28, Paul describes some things concerning Jesus, and he describes the appearance of Jesus. And in these three things, he wants to make sure that we understand how Jesus appeared. I'm just going to start reading verse number 24 and going down, and I'm going to show you something. Notice what it says. For Christ is not entered into the holy place made with hands, which are the figures of the true, but into heaven itself, now to appear in the presence of God for us. Nor yet that he should be offered himself often as the high priest enters into the holy place every year with the blood of others. Notice the past presence, the past appearance of Jesus. Look at verse 26. For then must he often have suffered since the foundation of the world, but now, once in the end of the world, hath he appeared to put away sin by the sacrifice of himself. We see the past appearance of Jesus on Calvary's cross. And this is what the apostle, he looks back and how he sees Jesus appeared in the past. Christian, let's look back. We just came out of a Christmas season. We talk about the baby Jesus. But listen, let me tell you something. Jesus' appearance at the cross, so very, very important. We could spend talking about the promises from the cross, and maybe one of these weeks to come we might. But notice something else. We know that he's ascended. What about his present appearance? What about that? Look at verse 24. How's it read? For Christ is not entered into the holy place made with hands, which are the figures of the true, but unto heaven itself, now appears in the presence of God. Question, why is he up there? Why is he standing in the presence of God? And the scripture says, for us. What's he doing? He's just making sure things stay the way they should stay between me and God. Scripture says, I've been reconciled unto God by Christ. The day Christ quits doing his job, I'm in trouble. Now you tell me, how secure am I? Because he says, I'll never leave you nor forsake you. We see the presence of God, the presence of Christ, what he's doing today for us. But wait. I call your attention down to verse 28 as we look at the future appearing. This is where we were. This is where we started. So Christ was once offered to bear the sins of many. And unto them that look for him shall he appear the second time without sin and salvation. There, let's just picture this now. Let's spend a little bit of time. Just a little bit. If we're going to see Jesus, and there really is no if to it, we are. We know what the Bible has to say. We will definitely cast our eyes upon the very presence of the Son of God. First John 2:28 says this. And now, little children, abide in him, that when he shall appear, we may have confidence and not be ashamed before him at his coming. John writes to this group of believers and says, listen, folks, it's so important that you understand what the word abiding in him means. The story is told that when Eisenhower was in office as president, they took a vacation to Denver, Colorado. And it was said that there was a young boy there that had inoperable cancer and was going to die. He had a desire to see the president. One day, the limousine pulls up in front of the house and there's a knock on the door. The father that's inside in blue jeans and an old shirt and two-day growing beard goes to the door and opens it up, and there stands the president. And the president asks to see the young boy, takes him out to the limo, and they have a good long conversation, and brings him back. And the father recalls that particular visit. He said, here I am. Old blue jeans, a worn-out shirt, and two-day growth beard. Meeting the president face-to-face. And I felt so ashamed. If he was expecting him, maybe he would have looked a little different. Now, I've been fortunate. God has been fortunate I've been fortunate for God to bless me with two beautiful children, five beautiful grandchildren. I've seen a lot of things in my life. And some of you have seen a lot more than I have. But the most beautiful thing that I've ever seen in my entire life, bar none, took place on the 25th day of August, 1970. And I was standing at the very front of a church. And the preacher was right there in front of us. and a particular song began to play. And everybody stood, and we began to turn, and for the first time, I saw my bride in her dress. Bar none, most beautiful thing that I have ever seen in my life. And on this earth, the most beautiful thing that I will ever see. Now, if we were to take that same dress today, and over the period of time, the dress has gotten smaller. The dress has gotten smaller. It's not as bright, as white as it was. And yet if my bride could put that on and come down the aisle to face us one more time, there wouldn't be the confidence there. Because of the way that she would appear, she might even felt ashamed a little bit. Think about this. Now, little children, abide in him. This is talking about fellowship. I don't know how close you are to Jesus, but you can't get too close to him. So when he does appear, and he will appear, you're going to face him one of these days. We're all going to face him. Are we going to be able to face him with confidence? Or are we going to be ashamed? Not be ashamed before him at his coming. But let me tell you something. I've got mixed emotions about this. This meeting with him. What am I going to say, if anything? Would I respond if you asked me something? And how would I feel in regards to that? The feeling of feeling so inadequate standing in the very presence of the Son of God. Now, here's a good part. No matter how I feel, I know how he's going to feel about me. You know how inadequate I may feel, or have not having the confidence that I should have. I know how he's going to feel about me. If there's one thing you can say about that very love that Jesus has for us, it's always the same. The very person that has spent eternity in a devil's hell, he loves them just as much as any of those that will spend eternity in heaven. Now, I know the scripture is very plain in regards to him returning. And we're going to see him. And we're going to face him. But let me leave you with a question, if I can. When you see Jesus, will it be a day of rejoicing or regret? That's a question that we need to just think about. Kind of reminds me of Forrest Gump when he was trying to figure out his mama's religion and Lieutenant Dan. I think they're kind of both right. You know, he's trying to figure that out. Listen, I think it's going to be both. I know it's going to be a day of rejoicing. And I'll never forget this as long as I live. is I experienced for the very first time the death of a parent. Me and my two brothers were there. Everyone has gone out. It's just us three boys now. They've already taken my father on out. There, me and Melvin Rick are there. I hear one of them say, no regrets, no regrets. And the other agrees and return and leave. And I couldn't say it. No matter how much you do, you could do more. I don't care how much you love Jesus now, we could love him more. No matter how busy we are for him now, we could do more. So just as the disciples had mixed emotions when he left that day, I think we'll have mixed emotions when he returns. It's not a day that we dread. As a matter of fact, in the last book of Revelation, John says, even so, Lord Jesus, come. He prays for the coming of Jesus. The very one that was on the Isle of Patmos because of his preaching, and the very one that Jesus appeared to at chapter number one, that very apostle felt so inadequate as he stood in his presence. And yet he's going to return, and we're going to see him. And I think this makes the difference for me. It's not that we're going to see him. But John simply says that we're going to see him as he is. I go back, if I can, to repeat what John says. He says this in chapter 3, verse 2, just quickly. It does not yet appear what we shall be, but we know that when he shall appear, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. Yeah, I like this part. We think we know Jesus. And yet there's going to be a time when we're going to see him as he is, the very Son of God that has brought salvation to us, the very Son of God that many times you and I have been like Judas and we've sold him out for far less than 30 pieces of silver. That very Jesus that's standing in the very presence of God right now, that when I pray to my Heavenly Father, he intercedes on my behalf. And that same Jesus that is looking forward to, he's looking forward to the day when the Father gives the command, hey, go get my children. Are you looking forward to that day? Can we pray as John prayed, even so, come Lord Jesus? Can we pray for the coming of the Lord, or do we want him to just tarry a little longer because of those that we think need a little more time to come to a saving knowledge of the Lord? There's so much that's just not done yet. And yet we know that when he does come, there's going to be things left that's undone. Should that challenge us today? Since we know this is a promise. This is a promise that he's returning. Know anyone that's going to be left behind? Each and every one of us know somebody. And since we know someone, do you not think that it should jar a sense of urgency within us? If we know that He's returning, He says this to His disciples. Fellas, let not your heart be troubled. I'm going away. Let me paraphrase this. I'm preparing a place. Then I'm going to come back and I'm going to get you and I'm going to take you home. We know that to be true, because we talked about the promises of God last week and how important it is to understand these particular promises. And here we find one. I'm not saying that it's the most important, but I'm telling you it's the very first one I preached about. That Jesus is going to come and we're going to face Him one of these days when we see Him. He's going to take us home, whether He does it through the rapture or He does it through the vehicle of death. We are going home, Christian. And we're going to face Jesus. How are you going to describe that moment? I know this for a fact. The Scripture says that every knee shall bow, every tongue shall confess. I don't care who you are, saved or lost, it doesn't matter. But I know this, that I'm going to bow. I'm going to be there. I'm going to praise. I'm going to worship. Of all the friends and loved ones that may be going on before me, the one that's the most important is one that I'm going to see. You mean to tell me that St. Peter's not going to bring me on in? Come on, folks, we know the story of that. I want to see Jesus. But how badly do I want to see Him? And do I long for that moment when I can tell Him face to face how much I love Him? Then when I think of that moment, I think of what Jesus said to His disciples here on earth. He said, fellas, if you love me, you'll keep my commandments. Oh, what a smart elder. He always had an answer, doesn't he? Always got an answer. So how do I show my love for Jesus? By being obedient to His word. That's abiding in Him. So I'll close with this last question. Are we abiding in Him? How often do you find yourself in this book during the week? How often do you find yourself searching Scripture? How often do you find yourself at the feeding trough or the fountain? How often? Your soul longs for this right here. And then when the opportunity comes and we have an opportunity to apply what we know to a life-changing experience, do we do that? We shall see Jesus just as He is. How well do we know Him? Not well enough here. Even John, the one that spent that much time with Him, still didn't know everything. But he said, when it come down to it, we shall be like Him. We shall know Him. Most of us know each other's names. many of us do not know each other as far as in depth. Some are closer than others. How much do we know about Him? We know how much He loves us, how much He cares for us. We know He's returning. If He were to return today, how would we face Him? His bowed eyes closed. Convict each and every one of us. And we thank You again for this promise that we can stand on. In Jesus' name, amen. Dave, what number? God spoke. How confident are you when Jesus returns? Would you come? As we sing together, would you come? I encourage you to be back tonight, Brother Bill. I asked him what he's going to be preaching about tonight. He shared with me, I wrote it down right here on this piece of paper. But he's got another promise lined up for you. Like we talked about, this year, the year of promises. He and I are going to be sharing some things about the promises of God. We started off this one. We're going to get to see Him. He's promised that. Going to get to see Him. Bill will share a challenging message with you tonight. Be in prayer for those. We've got a lot of our church family that's out today. And we know where many of them are. But be in prayer for those that are sick, not able to come. Listen, just do your best to stay as well. That's all I can tell you. Do your best to stay as well as you can, okay? We be in prayer for us. We've got some things we've got to take care of tomorrow. So we won't be here tonight. We can't get things ready. So you just be in prayer for us the next few days as we try to take care of some things. For those of you that may or may not know, Brother Rudy Ring right over there. Brother Rudy used to be a pastor at Walcott. He's been there before. And him and his wife, and they're back in the area to come to visit. I wanted to make sure that you make them welcome. You know, I looked at old Rudy and I said, well, he just looks the same. He ain't lost any hair. Takes him long to get ready in the morning, though. Okay. Make them welcome, okay? And Brother Rudy, would you dismiss us, please?